in one of the darkest times in human history, when the voice of God was silent for 400 years. Suddenly, without notice and without provocation, redemption came to all men. And on an old rugged cross, on the stony hills of Calvary outside of the city of Jerusalem, the sins of mankind were redeemed one final time as God expresses His love for all of man when He poured His wrath on His Son at a cross and it appeared that evil had won. He rose and He was resurrected. He lives that we may live. Grace and peace be unto you from God the Father and our glorious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to speak to you this afternoon on a subject I'm simply going to title, Who is Wise Among You? This is found in James 3, verse 13, when it says, Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge from among all of you? Let him show out of a good conversation or lifestyle his works with meekness and wisdom. So today I want to speak to you about a very neglected, disregarded, ignored, and slighted spiritual gift in all of the Scripture than a person's pursuit of biblical wisdom. The Scriptures are the source of all godly wisdom, and godly wisdom is the impartation of the Holy Spirit that we apply to all areas of our lives. It testifies of the maturity of the believer in Christ. The Scripture has much to say about the benefits of acquiring biblical wisdom. For example, in Job chapter 12, verse 12, the Bible says, With the ancient there is wisdom. James 3, verse 17, wisdom that is from God is above and is pure, peaceable, and gentle. Psalm 51, verse 6, the Bible says, In the secret parts God hath made us to know true wisdom. In Proverbs 2, verse 6, the Bible says, It is the Lord that gives wisdom. In Proverbs 9, verse 10, the Bible says, The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The Scripture says in Proverbs 3, 7, Be not wise in your own sight. Proverbs 3, verse 13 says, Happy is the man that finds wisdom. Proverbs 3, 21, Keep sound wisdom and discretion. Proverbs 4, verse 5, the Bible says, Get wisdom, get understanding, and don't forget it. Proverbs 4, verse 7, the Bible says, Wisdom is the principal thing, therefore, get wisdom. In Proverbs 4:11, the Bible says God teaches us the way of wisdom. Proverbs 10 verse 8, the wise in heart will receive commandments. Proverbs 10 verse 23, a man of understanding hath wisdom. Proverbs 11 verse 30, he that winneth souls is wise. Proverbs 12 verse 15, he that hears counsel is wise or receives instruction is wise. Proverbs 13:10, with the well-advised there is wisdom. And Proverbs 13:20, he that walketh with wise men will be wise himself. And Proverbs 14, verse 16, a wise man fears evil and departs from it. And Proverbs 16:23, the Bible says, the heart of the wise teaches our mouth to learn. In Proverbs 18, verse 15, the ears of the wise seek knowledge. In Proverbs 19, verse 8, the Bible says, he that gets wisdom loves his own soul. In Proverbs 24, verse 3, the Bible says, through wisdom is a house built, and by understanding it is established. Proverbs 29:11 says, a wise man holds his tongue. In Psalm 37, verse 30, the righteous mouth speaks wisdom. In Psalm 19, verse 7, the testimony of the Lord makes a simple man a wise man. In Psalm 90, verse 12, the Bible says, Teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. In Ecclesiastes 8, verse 1, the Bible says, a man's wisdom makes his face to shine with the glory of the Lord. In Ecclesiastes 10, verse 12, the Bible says, wisdom is justified. The words of a wise man or a wise man's mouth are gracious. Matthew 11, 19, the Bible says, wisdom is justified by her actions. And Luke 1, verse 17, the gospel turns the disobedient into the wisdom of the righteous. And Luke 21, verse 15, the Bible says, I will give you a voice of wisdom. And 1 Corinthians 1, 24, the Bible says, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And 1 Corinthians 1, 25, the foolishness of God is wiser than men. And 1 Corinthians 1, verse 30, Christ has become the wisdom of God for us. In Colossians 2, verse 3, the Bible says, in Christ has hid all of the treasures and the treasures of wisdom and the knowledge of God himself. In 2 Timothy 3, verse 15, the scriptures are able to make us wise unto salvation. In James chapter 1, verse 5, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, which gives to all men liberally and upbraideth it not. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed. Let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. For a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You cannot have the wisdom of this world and the wisdom of God in the same house. They are contradictory one to another. But if a man will pursue wisdom, biblical wisdom, godly wisdom, and do it by faith, nothing moving, God will give him wisdom beyond his years and the ability to discern all spiritual situations according to the leading of the Holy Spirit that's inside of him. In Matthew 7, verse 24, the Bible says, therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I shall liken him unto a wise man. Finally, in the book of 1 Corinthians 12, the first spiritual gift that the Holy Spirit reveals is not speaking in tongues. It is not interpretations. It is not prophetic. It is not the gift of knowledge. It is for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. It would be every Christian's greatest wonderful walk with God if they pursue passionately biblical and spiritual wisdom. Little of what is being thrown around in the name of revelation has anything to do with the scriptures. We would be advised in these difficult times to pursue the leading of the Holy Spirit to lead us into God's perfect wisdom. Today, I want to look at one set of scriptures. So how do we do that? How do we pursue biblical wisdom as Christians? Well, I think as biblical Christians, we ought to go to the source of all biblical wisdom, and that is in Jesus Christ. So today, pursuant to our message, we are going to speak from the Sermon on the Mount, from Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 27, and I want you to understand just how important and a priority it needs to be in your life for the pursuit of peace with God. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 27, the Bible says, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to get into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many shall say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? And in your name have we not done many wonderful works and cast out devils? And then I will profess to them the most terrifying words of the scripture. I never knew you. Depart from me, worker of iniquity. Therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I shall liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, but it would not fall, for it was founded upon a rock. But whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house on sand. and the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Luke chapter 6, verses 46 through 49 carries the same connotation. Luke 6, verse 46, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I tell you to do? Whosoever therefore comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you who he is like. He is like a man which built a house and dug deep and laid the foundations on a rock. And when the flood came, the street vehemently beat against that house, and it did not shake, for it was founded upon a rock." The Holy Spirit is not going to extrapolate the symbolism or the metaphorical explanation of the last four verses of the scripture. The obvious message in this illustration is that a wise man is a man that is not just a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word, but someone who applies. He applies the tenets of what he says in all of daily living. James chapter 1, verse 22, "But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only." And James chapter 2, verse 17 and 20, through 20, the Bible says, "Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show my faith without my works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe in God, you do well. The devils also believe and tremble. But will thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead?" When the Holy Spirit uses the redundancy of words or phrases of Jesus Christ, he is placing their importance and priority over all the others. While Scripture is the inerrant, infallible, indelible, and complete Word of God, it is the redundancy of the words of Jesus Christ that God is using the Spirit of God to emphasize his priorities on what he asks us to do while he's here, and the significance with which he who is giving the instructions. And Jesus Christ, as the instructor, with the emphasis of these words, is telling us and revealing to us God's will through him, because without him, we have no access to God. So it is through the words of Jesus Christ that we must enter the wisdom, the pursuit of our wisdom of the Father. The emphasis reinforces the heart of God in all matters and makes it much harder to distort, dilute, or change the will of God. It clearly gives direction for the believer in Christ to obey or disobey. I'm going to give you 10 phrases of Jesus Christ. There are others. There are many others. And there are more phrases multiplied than what I'm giving you. But I only have so much time, so I want to try to do these in no particular order of importance, but 10 statements of Jesus Christ that we can give to you on the genesis of your journey to biblical wisdom. Number one, the words themselves will never pass away. In other words, heaven and earth will pass, but my words shall never pass. In other words, what he's saying now will be written down and will be forever etched in the annals of human history as a testament to accepting or rejecting God's love in him. These are his words. And while he is the fulfillment of the law, he emphasizes through much of the scripture that it is his words that will never pass away. The Bible says in Matthew 24, verse 35, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." In Mark 13, verse 31, the Bible says, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall never pass away." In Luke 21, verse 33, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." Luke 16, verse 17, "And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one jot or one tittle of the law to fail." Matthew 5, verse 18, "Till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall by no means pass from the law until all is fulfilled." Number two, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." A very frequent statement in the scriptures. It means, he who is truly listening, please pay attention. Hearing and listening are synonyms, but have different implications, because you can hear somebody without actually listening to what is being said. Listening requires a person to pay close attention to the speaker, and it requires concentration. It means to understand that what is being said and providing an adequate response to it. Having ears to hear was a common expression to those whose hearts were ready to act upon the revelation of truth they were about to be given. And Matthew 11, verse 15, and Matthew 13, verse 9, and Matthew 13, verse 43. It says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And Mark 4, verse 9, the Bible says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And Luke 8, verse 8, and in Luke 14, 35, the Bible says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And Revelation 2, verses 7, verses 11, verse 17, verse 29, and Revelation 3, verse 3, verse 13, and verse 22, he makes the same statement to all of the churches of Revelation. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. It's vitally important that you have an ear to hear the voice of God. In John chapter 10, verses 1 through 5, the Bible says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not into the sheepfold by the door, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that enters through the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To whom the porter opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. And when he hath put forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger they will not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. They have so embedded themselves into understanding the voice of Christ that any other voice causes them to flee from the deception. Number three. The life for life swap. What do you mean by life for life swap? You have to die to self to be reborn in the Spirit to have fellowship with God. The old man must die. You must be reborn spiritually in the new birth. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 39, the Bible says, he that shall find his life shall lose it, and he that will lose his life for my sake shall find it. And Matthew 16, verses 25 through 26, for whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? And Matthew 8, 35 through 37, the Bible says, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, and here's something that is not in any of the others, and the gospel. Are you willing to lose your life for the gospel? The same shall save it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? In Luke 17, verse 32, verse 33, in verse 32 he says, remember Lot's wife. Whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall find it. Lot's wife died in a pillar of salt when she looked back at Sodom and Gomorrah when God had explicitly told her, your life is now with me. That didn't seem to be good enough. So when she looked back at her former life, longing to go back, she was consumed in a pillar of salt. You must die to self for this to work. In John chapter 12, verse 25, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. What does it mean, life for life? It means you must be born again. In John chapter 3, verses 3 through 8, the Bible says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you are born again, you shall not see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born again? And Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man is born of water of the Spirit, he is not going to enter the kingdom of God. There are no substitutions. There are no replacements. This is the narrow door. This is the only way. This is the only pathway to God to be born again. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and you don't know where it, and you hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it came from. You don't know where it's going. So is every man that is born of the Spirit. Notice the verse that says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Every time the gospel is preached, it requires and submits to a choice. And when you don't make a choice, you make a choice. You must give your life to Jesus Christ and be born again for the remission of sins at the cross of Calvary. Being born is a chance. Being saved is a choice. In verse 14 of the same chapter through 21, the Bible says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into this world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on the Son is saved, and he that believeth not on the Son is condemned already, because he believeth not in the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. He that doeth evil hates the light, and he's not coming to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth comes to the light, that his deeds are manifest, that they are wrought in God. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Number four, the doctrine of hell and the lake of fire. The final place of judgment of all who reject the gospel. God defines it in the following: eternal fire, darkness, weeping, and gnashing of teeth. Separation of the unrighteous from the righteous. Eternal punishment and separation from God. Jesus Christ spoke 92 times, 70 directly, about the doctrine of hell, emphasizing the avoidance of it. No other biblical character defines and describes hell more than the Savior who came to keep you from going there. You must always understand the number one reason that you need Jesus Christ is without him, you are eternally separated from God, and you must make your choice in eternity. Matthew 10, verse 26, very, very much relevant to his narrative when he walked the face of the earth. Matthew 10, verses 26 through 28, fear them not therefore that shall not be revealed, and hid that shall not be known. What I tell you in darkness, that speak to the light. And what you hear in the ear, that preach upon the housetops. And fear not them which kill your body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy your body and soul in hell. Listen to what I'm saying. Fear him which is able to destroy your body and soul in hell. And Luke 12, verses 2 through 5, the Bible says, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, and nothing hid that shall not be made known. Therefore, whatsoever you have spoken in darkness, it shall be heard in the light. And that which you have spoken in the ear shall be proclaimed from the housetops. And I say unto you, listen again, and I say unto you, my friends, fear not them that have the power to kill the body, and after that can do no more. But I will forewarn you whom you shall fear. Fear ye him that hath the power to cast, after dying, has the power to send you to hell. I say unto you, fear ye him. In Matthew 7, verse 13, the Bible says, enter in at the strait gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way, which leads to damnable hell, and many there be that go therein. In Matthew 13, verses 47, the kingdom of heaven. He spoke a parable about what happens when this is all over with. In Matthew 13, 47 through 50, the Bible says, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind. And when it was full, they drew it to shore and sat down and gathered the good into baskets, but cast the other one away. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from the just and shall cast them into the furnace of fire, and there be wailing and gnashing of teeth. In Matthew 7, verse 21 through 23, the Bible says, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to get into the kingdom of God, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many shall say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not cast out devils in your name? And have we not done many wonderful works? And have we not prophesied in your name? And then I will profess to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, worker of iniquity. Number 5. On the other hand, unconditional forgiveness of sins. How great is the love of God. When you come to the cross of Jesus Christ and you surrender your life to Him and you commit to Him and you confess your sins and give your life to Christ and believe on Him and follow Him and serve Him and obey Him and let His Spirit help you, you receive from the cross of Calvary, unconditional forgiveness of sins. No questions asked. He doesn't grade on the curve. As He judges, so great is His mercy. Cannot have the doctrine of hell without the doctrine of unconditional forgiveness. Jesus Christ died for your sins. You did not get, your sins did not go unpunished. He took the punishment of your sins on the cross at Calvary. He paid the price for your sins. And you have been forgiven because your sins remain no more because the love of God was manifested in the unconditional forgiveness of your sins. In Matthew 6, verses 12 and 14 and 15, the Bible says, "And forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. For if you can forgive men their trespasses, your Father which is in heaven will also forgive you." In Matthew 18, verses 21 through 22, the Bible says, "Then came Peter unto him and said, Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother his sins? Up to 7 times? And Jesus said, I say not unto thee unto 7 times, but more likely unto 70 times 7. In Mark 11, verses 25 through 26. And when you stand praying, forgive. Let me say this again. When you stand praying, forgive. When you stand praying, forgive any that you have aught against you, that your Father which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, then your Father will not forgive you your trespasses. Number 6, and I'm just skipping over stuff for time's sake. Number 6 is the fruit you bear. Fruit is what you did with what you have. What do you do with your spiritual gifts? What do you do with what God has called you to do? Are you doing what God has called you to do? The Bible was written in a time of agriculture. So all of these references are done from an agricultural perspective. How you treated the plants and the wildlife in that era determined how you were going to eat or how you were going to prosper. And the symbolism of fruit is an indicator of exactly how the kingdom of heaven looks at what you're doing while you're down here. In John 15, verses 1 through 7, the motivation for fruit is given and established by Jesus to His disciples. John chapter 15, verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that bears fruit, He purges it, that it might bring forth more fruit. And every branch that doesn't bear fruit, He cuts it off. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, nor can you except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. If a man does not abide in me, he is cast forth as a branch and withered, and men shall gather them up to be bundled, and they are thrown in the fire and burned. But if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. And Matthew 7, verses 16 through 20. You shall know your people, you will know your pastors and the prophets that preach to you by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, and a corrupt tree will not bring forth good fruit. And every tree that beareth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. For by their fruits you shall know them. In Matthew 12, verse 33 through 37, either make the tree good and the fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and the fruit corrupt. O generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure brings forth good things, but an evil man out of an evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by your words you'll be justified, and by your words you shall be condemned. Number 7, our witness before men. What does that mean? I know a lot of people who take the name of Jesus Christ that are ashamed of the Christian faith, that are ashamed to testify of his goodness in front of other people, particularly at work or around their families or a number of other venues that are an opportunity to win souls. Now, I'm not suggesting here that you become a great preacher or a loud preacher or someone who's not called to be. All you're asking is, hey, look, I'm a Christian, Jesus is my Lord, and your behavior reflects that, a commitment and a love that can be unquestioned and undenied by the devotion in your heart to him. There's a great lot of people that take the name of Christ as a convenience, that just to get them away from someone trying to help them in Christianity. That's not what we're talking about. There are a great number of people in Hollywood and in sports and in even areas of government and in the workplace who claim to be a Christian, but there's no fruit of it, and their confession is nominal at best to get it. Matthew 10, verse 33, this Bible says, Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father which is in heaven. In Mark 8, verse 38, the Bible says, Wherefore, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words and this adulterous and sinful generation, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed of when he comes in the glory of his Father with his angels. In Luke 12, verses 8 through 9, Whosoever shall confess me before men, Him shall the Son of Man also confess before the angels of God. But he that denieth me shall be denied before the angels of heaven. Number 8. This is a hard one. I never knew you. Depart from me, worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Far too many Christians are going to hear these horrifying words when they wind up there. You cannot serve the Lord Jesus Christ and live a life of iniquity. I'm not talking about one sin. Iniquity does not mean one sin. Iniquity means a bunch of sins, a bunch of willful sins. And there has been some very wide and broad margins in morality and in the Christian faith in this generation. And I can assure you, they have not changed in the kingdom of God. The definition of marriage is still the covenant between one man and one woman that will never, ever change, no matter how much this world tries to press you and whatever. The Bible says, in the beginning, he made them male and female. There are not 72 different genders and pronouns. He made them male and he made them female. This is a demonic attack against the godliness of God, and it will not go unpunished. You have to confess your Christian faith by your commitment to him in all areas of the life, even in the ones that make other people uncomfortable. You see, if you confess God before men, he doesn't mean before other members of the church. He means when you leave the church. He means when you go out in the world. He means when you're at the restaurant, at the job, at the dry cleaners, at the grocery store. Do people see God in you? Do you confess people? Do you confess Christ to your grocers? Well, wait a minute, that offends people. Okay? They don't mind sending you their godless tasteless jokes and their bad humor, and not a one of them's afraid to cuss at you, not concerned that you might be offended by it. So if they get offended by you, so be it. You're not trying to do a whole, all you're saying is God loves you. Jesus loves you. God cares about you. And if they give you trouble for that, then just move on with the rest of your life and don't worry about the fact. If you serve God, you're going to offend somebody. You're going to offend a bunch of people in the church. There's a lot of people that do this that are doing it for their own personal advancement. If you truly care about Christ, God will come first in everything. Many shall say unto me that, Lord, they, excuse me, Matthew 7:23. I've covered this a couple of times. I never knew you, depart from me, worker of iniquity. You're not going to have a double life and get to heaven. You must commit yourself. And people make mistakes. You must commit yourself to the gospel. Number 9 is repentance. And number 10 is watch. But I'm going to go with repentance because I'm sure I'm winding down my time here. We ask every service for repentance. When I go to a church, I don't care if they've all been there 100 years. We ask for repentance. When we go into a ministry, we ask for repentance. We ask for repentance everywhere we go because it is the door, the narrow door. And I am not going to leave any venue, including this one, without giving you an opportunity to know Jesus Christ. And in order for that to happen, first and foremost, you must be willing to repent of your sins, not only to confess them, but to repent them. And I know there are 1,000 different viewpoints on getting saved and what it means. I'm telling you, you're not going to get saved without repentance of sins. You're just not. That's what the cross represents. And if you can't stand there before under the throne of God, or under the cross of Christ, excuse me, and repent and confess of your sins and believe in your heart that the part of the problem with repentance is the only thing we're sorry about is we got caught. True repentance means that you are willing to change and to get a new life through the belief in Jesus Christ. And someone who says repentance is not applicable anymore simply means is suggesting that you do not have to change your life to be saved. And you do have to change your life to be saved. You cannot live like hell and have the gospel of Jesus Christ in your heart. At some point, something's got to give. And that something is you. He's not going to change just because this is hard to say. The Bible says in Matthew 3:8, bring forth repentance, fruits of repentance, meet for repentance. In Matthew 4, verse 17, the Bible says, from that time, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. One of the most harshest and emphasized scriptures of Jesus Christ in the scriptures is in Matthew 13, verses 1 through 5. It says, there were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answered and said unto them, suppose ye those Galileans were sinners above all the others. And Jesus said, I tell you, but except you repent, you're going to perish. Now, I don't know. This is said again, 2 verses down. I don't know where people get off saying you don't need to repent when it clearly is in the scripture that except you repent, you're going to perish. What does that mean? That means you're going to die and go to hell. Perish means you're going to perish spiritually. You will be separated from God. Without repentance, there is no remission of sins. It's not possible. You must repent of your sins. The Bible says in Luke 24, verse 47, and I know I'm skipping over scripture because D's looking at his watch. I know I got to round this up. Luke 24, verse 47, the Bible says, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name in all nations. And by the way, after he ascends and they go preach, in Acts 2, they say, men and brethren, what must we do to be saved? The first words out of Peter's mouth are, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. In Acts 3:19, the Bible says, repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come at the presence of the Lord. Number 10 is watch. Watch means that you are watching for his imminent return. in Matthew 24, verses 42 through 44, Luke 21, verses 34 through 36, and Mark 13, 33 through 37, he speaks of that. The simple fact of the matter is that if you're not looking for his coming, he's not coming for you. If you are not eagerly anticipating the return of Jesus Christ, he's not coming for you. If you don't have a beat in your heart, or you don't have an unction in your spirit for the joy that will come at the return of Jesus Christ, he's not coming for you. We are all looking and hastening for the day, the coming day of the Lord. That should be upon every Christian's heart that takes the name of Jesus Christ. I know I've spoken this to people who are searching for truth. If you are a sinner and you've caught this message, if you are a backslider away from God, or if you have considered yourself an apostate and don't know how to come back, God's door is open for all of you. These things he says, so that he can offer to you the correct version of himself in a world where revelation interpretation is very abstract, very scattered, and has at least an element of deception in there. These 10 sayings of Jesus Christ, we did not do all the scriptures we had. We did not say all the sayings he has. But I can assure you that if you will invest your time in learning the words of Christ and in learning the words about Christ versus every other thing that people are talking about, and you put your heart and spirit to this, you will learn who he is and how significant and important he is in God's process for the redemption of the souls of mankind. Because without him, there is no salvation. There's none other name. So I'm asking today, if you don't know Jesus in your heart, at whatever level you find yourself in, I'm asking you to bow your heart and speak to him and offer to him your confession and repentance of your sins to that point and ask him to come into your heart and then believe on him for the rest of your life. Now, I don't mean just say believe he is who he is. Even atheists believe Jesus Christ is alive. What it means believe, it means an action verb that you are to consecrate and commit yourself wholly and fully to obedience to his lordship and to follow him as best you can as he offers his grace and mercy to you as he prepares to meet you in heaven. I want to pray and then we're going to close this. Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, we have struggled trying to hold on to the truth in a day of deception, in a day of marketing, in a day of secular humanism, and a day where everybody's opinion thinks they're right. These are his words. These are not my words. I ask you to honor them. And Father, I am asking you to honor us as a ministry. If we are pleasing in your sight, we ask you to find a way for us to keep going, spiritually, financially, and hopefully in the center of your will. For the lives we touch and the messages we bring, we seek nothing more than your glory and your approval. To each and every person, I highly recommend that you consider the status and the state of the condition of your soul. For eternity is a long time, and you could be gone at any moment. Don't make the same mistake a lot of people have. Don't let your heart be deceived with this world and lose the one to come. It is my heart as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ that every single person that wants the truth will hear it, and that every single person that possibly can be saved from going to hell will be saved from going to hell. That's what this ministry's for, to know Jesus Christ, the one true way to God, and to have peace with him forever. Amen and amen.